Ladies and gentlemen, if you could get settled in, we'll start here in about 2 minutes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm your NELC Delegates Officer for the spring. We will now welcome an expert on leadership and resilience to the stage. Dr. Celeste Raver is currently the Director of Influencer Development at the Stockdale Center for Ethical Leadership. She obtained her PhD in Organizational Leadership from the University of Maryland Eastern Shore. Please welcome to the stage Dr. Raver.
Good afternoon. It's great to see all you. I can't really actually see you because the lights are so bright, but it's great to think you're in the audience and sort of see you. So I'm Celeste Raver, and to give you a little bit of background, I work here at the Naval Academy. My title is Director of Influencer Development, and I like to say I have the best job here at the Naval Academy. What I get to do is leadership development for our faculty, staff, and coaches. So what that really means is through them, I get to have an impact on the midshipmen. I get to think about leadership development and how to develop the midshipmen every single day. So it's a pretty awesome job, but that's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm actually here to talk about some of my research. Before I get into that, I want to kind of start with one thing that I think is really important. I've been throughout my career at lots of conferences and kind of been to various things. And it's interesting as I've sat and kind of watched this conference and observed it, and I've been so impressed because I've been here before, but never as a speaker. And I've been kind of watching the flow. I've been watching the midshipman team. And I'm thinking about this group of students is half my age. They're half my age. And they're planning, organizing, and executing this conference. So for that, I think that team, the NALC team, really deserves a round of applause. So I'm going to start with a little story and to frame this conversation. When I got the email that said, Dr. Raver, we want you to talk at the NALC conference, my first reaction was, they must have this wrong. They got to mean a different Dr. Raver. Why the heck are they asking me? My next reaction was, went to a bunch of people and said, did you put them up to asking me? Why are they asking me? And they're like, no, they're asking you. So I responded, I'm incredibly honored. Of course I'll talk. What the heck do you want me to talk about? Because I'm looking at the title. I knew some of the speakers. I knew some of the great panels that were happening. Returned with honor. Trials to triumph. I'm a civilian. What the heck do I know about these things? And when I sat down with the team and I said, what do you want me to talk about? Like, well, we want you to talk about your research on resilience and grit. It's like, my research on resilience and grit? What time is the talk? 13:30. Okay, how long am I talking? 45 minutes. Ooh, I'm gonna put everybody to sleep. Probably put myself to sleep. So I'm not quite sure what I'm gonna talk about, but I'll talk about it, sure. I'll do it. So that's how I started thinking about this. And what I really, though, started thinking about is with grit and resilience and honor and courage, all these amazing things we've talked about for the last couple days is, how do you develop them, right? That's what we're trying to get to. And I could stand up here and I could talk about my research and maybe I'd keep some of you awake and I would be really excited. I actually probably wouldn't fall asleep because I'm really passionate about these things, but many of you might. And so if I just focus on the knowledge and the knowledge alone, I'm not going to get anybody or many of you to be more resilient, to be grittier. And so there was a great question asked this morning with the flag panel about optimism. Well, that's great. We hear that optimism is part of these things all the time. How do you develop it? How do you train it? It's a fantastic question. That's what I'm hoping to focus on this afternoon. How do you develop grit? How do you develop resilience? Well, what you do, you first get some knowledge. So we're going to focus on a little bit of knowledge, go through that pretty quickly. The next thing, and what we're going to spend the rest of our time doing, is focusing on actions. Because what happens when you learn to do changes, you learn actions, over time those actions become habit. And as things become habit, they become internalized values. And then we start to be those things. We start to be more resilient. We start to be grittier. And that's ultimately what we want. That's what we want to take away from a conference like this. So under your seats, there's four cards placed for you. If you'll reach under and grab those four cards, you're going to need them throughout the conference or throughout this talk. If you don't have them, move to another seat and grab those four cards. So, one of the things that I think I like to know about people is their stories. Why are you interested in certain things? Why do you want to go to a military academy? Why did you come to this conference? What's interesting to you? So I'm going to start with my why. Why do I care about grit and resilience? Why am I so passionate about these two things? Because I failed. I failed a lot. When I was most of your ages in the room, between the ages about 17 and 23, I cannot tell you how many times I failed. Like many of you, I was top of my high school class. I was president of my school. I was an athlete. But I failed so many times in college that really shaped who I was for the next 15 years until I started studying grit and resilience. And so I started to understand what it is that enables people to withstand challenges, to persist, to persevere. And so that's what fascinates me about these things. And then as I ran an organization in that time frame, and we really didn't do that well a lot of times, we failed a lot. I realized there's really interest in what makes organizations thrive, what makes them persist. So that's what drove me to study these things. So as a researcher, when I look at various things, when I watch kind of scenes and videos and people, I look at them through the lens of grit and resilience. So I'm going to play a video clip here in a second. Bear with me, the quality is not that great. Why? Because it's 2008, before we used our cell phones for every single thing, picture and video we took in our lives. So the quality is not that great. But what the video and the video quality also demonstrates, the grit and resilience are displayed by everyday people. The video some of you may have seen, it's of a runner from the University of Minnesota who falls during a race. I want you to watch the video and then we're going to talk about it briefly. Thank you. So I looked at that video and I asked a couple of questions with somebody that kind of thinks in the terms of grit and resilience. I wonder, what was she thinking? What drove Heather to stand back up? And I think about it and I wonder, you know, she could have just walked off and found her coach. Nobody would have ever seen this video. Nobody would have remembered. She probably would. Probably have been an impact on her life. But it really wouldn't have been that big of a deal. In the reality of things, it wouldn't have been that big of a deal. But why did she get back up and then run probably faster than she's ever run before or even thought she was capable of running? Why did she do that? What was it that made Heather do that? I look at it and say it was grit. The reason I say it was grit is because she probably had a goal. She probably had a goal to race in this race, maybe to win the race, maybe to get a certain time. She probably had that goal that is what drove her to stand back up. In interviews after this race, she says, when asked, what were you thinking about? What made you get back up and finish that race? She said, I was thinking about the points my team would lose if I didn't finish the race. So in that's a little bit of team grit. She was thinking of something bigger that was driving her to move forward. But when I look at that, I still wonder, as somebody that lacked that when I was younger, what is it? What's different about her? How can we understand Heather? How can we understand why she's standing back up? Well, ideally, it's probably through lots and lots of practice that she got there. Lots of kind of mental work that drove her to get there. And that's where we're going to get with some of these actions. So I'm going to first give you the little bit of the knowledge of these concepts. One of the things we know about grit and resilience is they're talked about really in the same kind of sentence. They're talked about kind of, people will say you're gritty or you're resilient. But we actually know from research that they're correlated, related, but not so highly related that they're the same. There's some nuanced differences, and they're a little bit important for us to understand. So resilience. How many people have heard the term resilience? I think probably everybody has their hand up. Makes sense. Somebody give me a definition. Shout it out. Awesome. The ability to overcome an obstacle or a loss. So that's usually what people get to, the ability to overcome an obstacle or loss. There's a piece with that that's not often provided in the definition. There's a piece about adaptation that's really important for us to understand with resilience, whether we're talking about individual resilience, team resilience, or organizational resilience. There's a piece where as somebody's overcoming this obstacle, they're adapting to be able to get through that setback. And one of the things with resilience that's really important is it works kind of like this. So we know this from the theory. We all exist from kind of theory and some research, but it's hard to quantify this. But we all exist at kind of a baseline level. We kind of go about life at this kind of steady state. Something bad happens. And when somebody is displaying resilience, they're displaying these various habits that enable them to overcome this. I think Brad Snyder yesterday in his talk gave a perfect example of this, and I'm going to tap into it because as he was speaking, I was thinking about this framework. So as he woke up in the hospital and he kind of started to realize that he was blind, he was going into a sixth surgery, and they said you have a 1% chance of seeing, perceiving light and dark in your right eye. And it was kind of at that moment that he starts to realize, oh, what they're telling me is I'm blind. And as the doctors explain more, they say, we had to take out your left eye, and this is your chance to perceive some light and darkness. And he told us that that surgery didn't work. He's completely blind. And as he came to realize he was completely blind, he started going through all the things he could no longer do. I can't see the palm trees. I can't see the beautiful golf that I love. And he could have kept doing that and spiraling down that spiral. But what he did is he said, I can do these things. These are all the things I can do. And so he started walking up that mountain, and he got to a new state. As he got to that new tip of that mountain, he had more skills. He had more abilities to withstand ever and ever greater challenges and setbacks. This is what we see with resilience, is that your baseline gets higher as you face setbacks. But it only does that when we put in some active work, those activities we're going to do in a few minutes. The one thing that I think is really important with resilience, and I think a little bit misunderstood, and sometimes why it gets criticized, is a lot of times we want to say, well, what about the person at the very top? Can they not fall down to the very bottom? Absolutely. We don't know what that event's going to be in our life. We don't know when it's going to come. But the hope is that if you've built up these skills, you have these habits, you value certain things, you value the way you look at life, it's going to enable you to climb all the way back up again. It may take a while. It's probably not going to be easy, but you can get back there again. So let's move on and talk about grit a little bit and understand the nuanced difference with grit. Somebody, who's heard about grit in here, this term grit? Again, probably everybody, it looks like. Somebody shout out a definition of grit. Okay, kind of developed over time. Anybody else have a piece they want to add? Okay, that catches the other part, the ability to stick with something difficult. This is the nuanced difference with grit. As Duckworth, who's the seminal author on individual grit, says, it's passion and perseverance towards a long-term goal. So it's not just, I want to run faster in 2 weeks. It's, I want to become an admiral. It doesn't happen overnight, right? That's going to take years. It's going to take a whole career. But you stick with that over time. You're going to face setbacks, and you're going to adjust as you face the setbacks to reach that long-term goal. At the team and organizational level, we see something very similar. We've defined it as a team or organization's ability to focus on a central purpose, and because of that focus on the central purpose, have the ability to withstand failures and setbacks. So what do these frameworks look like? At the individual level, people that are really gritty, they may not know they do this. It's kind of under the surface. But they operate with this higher order goal structure is what we call this. And so one of the things for any students I've had in my class, I actually make them do this. They set a 5 to 10 year goal at the very top, and they think of all the lower order goals it's going to take for them to get there. They may already be working towards that. And it looks so simple, but it's really pretty hard when you start thinking about this. But we see this. I do some research with Captain Select Ledford at BUDS, a study that he put together several years ago, and we have a whole team working on it. And we see this with the SEAL candidates, the complete BUDS. That's what we're looking at. We're looking at grit, resilience, hardiness, and what it is that helps these individuals persist through the 6 months of BUDS. And we look at them using surveys, and we take biomarkers, and we look at them qualitatively as well. And what we see for those that have been able to complete BUDS is that they have this higher order goal of becoming a SEAL. That's their higher order goal in this case. And they have all these lower order goals. So the enlisted sailors that they want to become a SEAL. It's not like 2 weeks before boot camp usually that they've decided, oh, I want to be a SEAL. They've decided that years before. They've started to identify with the role of becoming a SEAL. And they've set all these other lower order goals. Get used to being in cold water. Be able to do a certain number of pull-ups. Develop my ability to run long distances. That help get them on that path to becoming a SEAL, to reaching that higher order goal. At the team and organizational level, or really at the organizational level, we see a very similar structure. What we see, though, is we see an organization's focus on its central purpose or mission. And when I say this, for anybody that's been familiar or worked in organizations, I don't mean their mission statement. So one of the things, I studied several organizations that kind of met a criteria that I would say made them gritty. And I would go and study these organizations. I spent about a month at each one. And I did interviews from the lowest level employees to the top employees, and I'd ask them all a similar series of questions. One of the questions I'd asked is, I'd say, what's your mission? And they'd sit there, unless they were the top level employees, and their eyes would bug out of their head, and they're like, oh my gosh, I'm failing the test. Don't tell my boss. And I'd let them sit for a second, and I'd say, no, I don't mean your mission statement. I mean your purpose. I mean why you're here every day. They go, whoo, oh, I'm here to make high-quality baked goods for the commercial bakery I studied. I'm here to help the community for the local government agency that I studied. I'm here to connect with the community for the retail pharmacy that I studied. These were all mid-sized companies, so they had about 150 to 300 employees. But that central purpose was infused from the top of the organization to the lowest level employees. It was very clear they all aligned around that. So that gives us a little bit of the framework of grit and resilience. So now we're going to move into the action. You have the knowledge now. Now let's do some action. So again, as we move into this section, it's a little different, a little out of the box. But what I want you to take with you as you leave here is I can't walk with each one of you and get you to be different, get you to be grittier, get you to be more resilient. Only you all can do that. And only you all can do that by taking various things and acting a little bit differently, incrementally different. The three things we're going to go over are things that we know are consistent with grit and resilience. Again, they're slightly distinct, but these three things are helpful to developing grit and resilience. One other thing I'll say before we get into this section. It was interesting because last night I was having a conversation with the command chaplain, and he said, well, Celeste, can we develop grit? I said, well, you're asking me a loaded question. I'm about to talk about this tomorrow, I hope so. And here's the thing, if I'm being completely honest with you as a researcher, it's not absolute. None of these soft social science skills are absolute. I would lie to you if I were. We don't have all the answers, we're trying to figure it out. That's why I'm so curious about that Heather that stood back up. But, and this is a big but, I think if we assume that we can't develop them, then we're all in trouble. Why are we here? So we have to make the assumption, a little bit of a leap, that there's certain things that we know are foundational to them, that we can work on through actions, that then become values that then help us be grittier, be more resilient, or on other concepts we talk about, be more honorable. So I'm going to talk about these three things that help us to be, I hope, more resilient and grittier. I want you to take your first card and write purpose on the top of it. You know, as you write that down, I'm sure some thoughts came to mind about what purpose means. I hear it, and I don't quite know what it means. Like, give me a good definition of purpose. I don't know. Somebody give it what you think a definition of purpose is. Your meaning? Okay, your meaning or drive. I like that. We're going to stop with that one. Your meaning or drive. Your meaning or drive. I think that's a really good way to start. So, purpose is interesting to me, so I'm going to talk about research for a minute, and then I'm going to give a little bit of a personal story. So from research, one of the things, I'm going to go back to some of the research that Captain Select Ledford, myself, and a whole team have done at BUDS. What we see with these individuals that persist through BUDS is that they are driven not only to become a SEAL, that's the grit piece, but they also have this purpose that's their meaning or drive. And what that means when we ask them kind of what it is, it'll be something like to serve the country, to protect the nation, to represent my family. It will be something that's their meaning or drive. And they utilize that when things don't go as planned. When they break a leg at the end of Hell Week and they get rolled back a class, maybe two classes, maybe three, as they rehab their leg, and then they pick up again and finish complete buds. So we see that meaning or drive being kind of central to it. At the organizational and team level, both grit and resilience at kind of the team and organizational level, there's purpose that's infused into them. I just spoke about it from the grit research I've done myself. And what's really interesting in it and in the organizations I've studied is that this purpose is embedded into the value system, the culture of the organizations. And it doesn't matter if the senior leader changes or not, that purpose is foundational to it. And that's what people from the lowest levels to the top levels kind of adhere to. And when they face setbacks, what drives them. So here's the personal piece. My parents, who happen to be in the audience, are Dr. Sue and Dr. James Raver. They're both medical physicians. And I'm pretty honored that I got to be the daughter of two physicians. Many people don't have that. And I was always so proud of it. I always was like, oh, yes, both my parents are doctors. And it wasn't because they were both doctors, and that's pretty cool. It was because they were so proud in what they did. And they worked really hard. I mean, really hard. And so I'd ask them from a very young age until now, Mom, Dad, why do you want to become doctors to help people? Mom, Dad, why do you work so hard to help people? This is before cell phones for all the younger folks in the room. Mom, Dad, while you were driving to vacation and you get a beep, that's how you got messages before, and you have to pull over to the side of the road and find a payphone to make a call, why do you do that? To help people. They always told me the same answer, over and over and over. I didn't realize until as much later, and I'm studying grit and resilience, what they were telling me every single time is they were telling me their purpose. And I couldn't understand that for so long, but that's what drove them. That's why they worked tirelessly. My dad would come home from work every day after leaving for work at, I don't even know when, 7 a.m. He'd come home from work for dinner at like 8:30 at night, have dinner with his four children, because yes, there were still four of us, even though they were both very busy, and he would go back to work. Dad, why are you going back to work? Well, I'm here to help people. So every time I asked them that question, no matter how I asked them, they were telling me their purpose. So what I want you all to do on that card is I want you to think about this for a minute or two and write down what's your purpose. This is not your leadership philosophy. This is not a mission statement. This is a 3-to-5-word sentence that drives you. As you start to think about it, I'll give you a couple that I've heard over this last couple of days. To make an impact, to build connection, to influence others, to serve the country, to think differently, to teach. Those are just a few as I've talked to different people over the last couple of days that they've said their purpose is. So with that, I'll give you some time. Okay, we're going to move on to the next thing. We're going to come back to how we turn this into action at the very end. On your next card, I want you to write, what's your lens? So it's set up perfectly. I feel like it was a bit of a plant this morning when we had a student asked, how do you train optimism? This was a perfect setup. Thank you, wherever you are, thank you. So, this is a really good question. It's really hard to answer. You all see a glass on the projector. What do you see? Glass half full? Glass half empty. If you're like me, you might say, I don't know if it's half empty or half full. Something my kid's about to spill. Yeah, I kind of see that too. But at least because it's only half empty, it's only going to be half, right? But, you know, one of the things we say, you all have heard this, oh, you're a half full person, you're a half empty person. Maybe it's neither half full or half empty if you're kind of like me. But this is like a cliche thing, but it exists for a reason. And we know from research and from theory that for grit and resilience to work, there has to be hope. There has to be optimism. There has to be positivity. But when you're the person that sees the glass half empty, it's really hard to change. Or when you say, I don't know if that glass is half empty or half full, it's really hard to change. I get it. I'm one of those people. I get it. But here's some things you can do. And you can also do them when you're a glass half full type of person. You got to understand what they are. You got to understand what positivity is. So on the other side, you see this line. It says, it's a great day to be alive. Last summer, I took a course in Clifton Strengths as a Clifton Strengths coach. Anybody taken the Strengths Finder? So what that does, for those of you that haven't, you take an assessment. It ranks you on 34 strengths. Essentially, it's like a personality test. You usually get your top five, and they say that kind of represents who you are. So as I took this course, and I sat down, you partner up with somebody to learn all the strengths. I happened to be partnered with somebody, their first top strength was positivity. Like, this is great. I can learn all about positivity. And I was really excited. And I said, you know, can you tell me what positivity means to you? And he goes, it's a great day to be alive. And I was like, that's awesome. And I immediately thought of the person in my life that's, it's a great day to be alive type of person. And I was like, okay, I understand positivity a lot better now. And that was great, right? But as somebody that doesn't operate like that, how do you develop that? How do you figure out how to develop that? Well, you develop it by social support. This is talked about, again, in this conference multiple times over and over again. The best story, though, I think came last night. As Charlie Plum talked about, he's in his cell, his 8x8 cell. He's trying to deal with the 8 inches between his head because it was so over all-consuming of what's going to happen. And he's thinking he's all alone. And he hears what he thought was a cricket, right? He hears what he thought was a cricket next to him. And he goes, and there's no cricket, but he sees this wire. And he pulls on the wire, and it gets pulled back. And his realization that another human was on the other side was all he needed in that moment. That's social support. That's how you turn that glass from half empty to half full. You need to know who your person is that can say, it's a great day to be alive, or can help you realize that it's not so bad. So ponder this question for a minute. Don't write anything down yet. The next part of this goes, what if you're the person that it's natural for you to be positive? You're a it's great day to be alive type of person. Aren't you going to have bad days? Absolutely. So I happened to ask my friend the other day that I thought of when I thought of this it's great day to be alive person. I said, okay, well, what do you do when the days are really kind of bad, when they suck, and that glass is half empty? And he said, well, I say this is going to pass. This will pass. I'm like, mantras, of course, mantras. And I thought about mantras. And you see one on the wall back here. And my 6-year-old son feels really big. He feels really big feelings, and it's pretty awesome. But he also feels really big and gets really upset, gets really angry, and gets really down on himself. So I came up with this mantra for him. I'm calm. I am strong. I am brave. I can do this. I'm calm. I am strong. I am brave. I can do this. And we'll say it at night sometimes when he's going to bed. And I found myself last year as I faced a pretty large personal challenge saying that mantra. Over and over, I'm calm, I'm strong, I'm brave, I can do this. And that mantra, maybe said 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 times, helped me start to see that the world wasn't ending, that the glass wasn't necessarily half empty, that maybe it was half full. So mantras can help us be a little more optimistic when we think about what we need to do. So on that second card, I want you to write down two things. Who is the person or group you can go to for support? And what's your mantra? Now, I know some of you may still be thinking, but in the interest of time, I'm going to keep moving. On your third card, I want you to write on the top of it, failures. We talked about this a little bit this morning with our flag panel. I'm going to bring us all down as we start to leave this room. Sorry. Hopefully, I'll bring you back up. But just write failures. On the board behind me is a list of, I don't even know, maybe a third of my failures, maybe a quarter, maybe an eighth. They're all there. I know they're there. They weigh pretty heavy. Get a little nervous thinking about all of those on the board. And there's many I didn't put up there. And when I sit there and I think about all those failures, there's a weight on my shoulder. I can physically feel it right now sitting on my shoulder. It's heavy. It hurts. That sucks. So, now that you all are heavy, let's write down three failures. So here's the thing with failure. If I leave these on the board and I go home tonight, I might not even make it home. I might be under this podium crying, curled up in a ball, hoping you all just leave quickly, right? Doesn't feel very good. But the thing we know about gritty and resilient people is that they are constantly reframing their failures. The Dont talked about this in day one, about growth mindset. Well, growth mindset, we know from research, is at the core to being resilient and being gritty. And what that means is that you're reframing failures. I'm going to take one that, at least for our midshipmen in the room, should be familiar. Failed to jump off the 10-meter. This just happened this semester. So one of the programs I run is I have faculty, staff, and coaches go off the 10-meter. Anybody that knows me, I am petrified of heights. Petrified of heights. I mean physically scared of heights. And I knew that this was something I needed to do. I'm a leader of this group. I need to go off the 10-meter. Okay, great. Day came, didn't prepare really well. Time to go off the 10-meter. I got up there, and I freaked out. Sat down on the ground, shaking, doing my mantras. Couldn't get off the 10-meter. Well, I'm admitting that to you, midshipmen. Don't hold it against me. So, did I fail? Maybe, but I did get off the 5-meter. For me, that was a pretty big deal. I was really scared on that 5-meter. I was shaking. I had tears coming out of my eyes, but I made it off the 5-meter. And I'll get off the 10-meter. Might take me a little longer. I've gotten up on my roof of my house twice to work on my fear of heights. Know that's a step. Because what I didn't do the first time is I didn't prepare adequately, knowing what a big fear I had. I should have prepared more. So what did I learn? How do I reframe this? I got off the 5-meter, I've gotten up on my roof twice, and I know how to prepare better. I can reframe my failure. So on that fourth card, you're going to partner with somebody next to you, and you're going to work on reframing your failures. When you finish reframing your failures, you're going to stand up, and there are several trash cans placed strategically around the auditorium. You're going to throw out your failure card, and you're going to sit back down with three cards. Purpose, what's your lens, and reframing failure card. So on that fourth card, it should say reframing failures, and you should reframe those three failures with your partner. And then again, you'll throw out your failure card and sit back down. So I know I'm cutting the best part short, but we're down to 4 minutes. So if you haven't thrown out your failure card, please don't hold on to it. You will throw it out on the way out the door. However, I want to wrap this up with one quick thing. The thing is, we talked about three really important things that can be tied to action. But what I feel I left you short with on those is, what are you actually doing every day, right? I said, I can give you the knowledge. I can give you some general things to tie to action, but I can't leave with you and help you act differently. So I want you to turn over each of your cards. On the back of your purpose card, I want you to write, what daily actions enable me to fulfill my purpose? So going back to the story about my parents, it's interesting, they both retired in 2015. And you'd think, if their purpose is to help people, how do they continue to do that? Well, about the same time I started my PhD program, and I had two kids, a two-year-old and a three-month-old. And they are fundamentally the only reason I got through my PhD program, because they helped me almost every single day with my kids so I could get through it, to help people. It's remained their purpose ever, even though they've retired. So what are you doing daily to fulfill your purpose? On your what's your lens card, I want you to write down two things. Seek out others and remember your mantra. So when you're having that awful day, when the glass is half empty, I want you to figure out who in your life can make you feel like maybe it's not the best day in the world, but it's not such a bad day to be alive. I want you to use that mantra. Maybe you have to say it 100 times, but use that mantra to get you to the other side. And finally, on your reframing failure card, because again, if you haven't thrown out your failure card, you're going to throw it out, I want you to write, consider another perspective. So that as you're thinking of, oh crap, I failed and I didn't get off that 10 meter, what's the other way you can look at that? How do you reframe that? So you aren't weighed down by all those things that don't go exactly as you plan. So we're kind of unfortunately out of time. I'm here though, I'd be happy to answer questions, but that's it for my talk. I'll stand down here if you want to ask any questions, but please, please don't hold on to that failure card. Please throw it out. Have a great day.
Ma'am, thank you for being here today, and on behalf of the NOW staff, we have a gift for you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. All right, we're going to have a 15-minute break, so please stretch your legs, use the bathroom, get some coffee, drop off your failure cards on your way out, and we'll be back in here. Please be seated by 25 so we can get ready for the next panel.